That's what God wants us to be here in Memphis, Tennessee. We need to be a catalyst for spiritual awakening, and we do that by loving Jesus Christ.
Good morning, and thanks for joining us for today's program. Today, Pastor Steve will be continuing our verse-by-verse study through the book of Acts. Have your Bibles ready and join us. We'll also be joining Donna Gaines for her weekly Bible study, Fresh Brewed Faith, and we'll take a look at some of the things God is doing around our city and in our church, and enjoy some great worship from our choir, orchestra, and worship band. And if you're looking for encouragement to get through the week or want to catch up on some recent messages, go online and check out our audio and video on demand at bellevue.org. You can also follow us on social at Bellevue Memphis throughout the week for inspirational and encouraging stories. The Bibles for China Thrift Center in Memphis is one of many stores in the U.S. operating under the Bibles for Missions Ministry. As part of our partnership, Bellevue helps support the ministry by providing donations and helping to coordinate volunteers. Listen to this story from Steve Hyde about how it works and how you can be a part.
My name is Steve Hyde. I've been a missionary in Cambodia for almost 25 years now. When I first got to Cambodia, there were almost no Christians there. So one of the things I had to do was to translate the Bible into Cambodian. I just graduated from college, and 1 month after I got my diploma, I got on an airplane, went to Cambodia, and I was a two-year project. And we started sharing the gospel. I met friends. I would teach them how to share the gospel. We'd go out, and one by one, people would come to Christ, and new churches would be planted. And now we are 24 years later, and I've never left Cambodia until this year, 25 years later, because now there's over 1 million Christians in Cambodia. There's over 10,000 churches, and there's a lot of work to be done there. And I can literally see before me the nation of Cambodia changing. And that's just the result of the gospel going through and impacting the culture of the country.
Bellevue is proud to support ministries in both Cambodia and China through the Bibles for China Thrift Center. Since our partnership began in 2014, we've raised an average of $100,000 annually, and 100% of those funds have gone directly to missions. This is only possible because volunteers give their time each week to keep the store running smoothly, and the greatest need now is for people willing to serve out through the Bibles for China Thrift Center. Volunteer once a week, month, or quarter, serving out at least 4 hours per shift. We need everyone, from cashiers to people sorting clothes, pricing items, sorting books, checking electronics, and picking up donations from donors.
Every person that works inside the store, they're sorting through things, they're going through clothes, they're going through furniture, they're helping people buy stuff, ship it out. Because of what they're doing there, that's providing Bibles for us right in Cambodia. We send out about 50,000 Bibles a year, and those are all brand new Christians that are coming from a Buddhist background or atheist background. So thank you to Bellevue for being a part, Bibles for China, to keep me over there and to keep Bibles in the hands of Cambodians.
The role of every volunteer is vital at the Bibles for China Thrift Center. We hope you'll consider giving your time to ensure that the people in Cambodia and China receive the gospel. To find out how you can volunteer, stop by Bellevue's missions office, the Thrift Center, or go online at bellevue.org/missions.
Oh,
Each week, our ladies meet for a time of fellowship, encouragement, and Bible study with Donna Gaines. This fall, we're going through the book of Hebrews under the title Fresh Brewed Faith. This study has been so popular, we want to share a word from Donna Gaines with you today. Join us here at Bellevue or live online as we explore the biblical truths in this book and discover the difference a fresh brewed faith can make.
Okay, as we jump into chapter 10, let's look at verses 1 and 2. For the law, since it has only a shadow of the good things to come, and not the very form of things, can never, by the same sacrifices which they offer continually year by year, make perfect those who draw near. Otherwise, would they not have ceased to be offered? Because the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have had consciousness of sins. Now remember, we're going to realize the blood of Jesus cleanses us, not just outwardly, but inwardly, and it cleanses our what? Our conscience. So it is in Christ that literally the awareness of our sin, the guilt, the shame can be removed in Jesus Christ. And he's saying the old sacrificial system could not do that. In fact, the Old Testament is full of physical pictures of spiritual realities. And it was these things, the sacrificial system, that pointed to the ultimate sacrifice that would be laid down for us on our behalf through Jesus Christ. Now let's jump down to verses 8 through 10 and let's look at the Levitical system. After saying above, sacrifices and offerings and whole burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, you have not desired, nor have you taken pleasure in them, which are offered according to the law. Then he said, behold, I have come to do your will. He takes away the first in order to establish the second. By this will, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Now, this past week, you did a comparison of the Levitical system and Jesus as our high priest and the ultimate sacrifice. And you've got some comparisons here on your handout as well. So under the Levitical system, there were literally thousands of priests who served through the years. But under our high priest, we know there is one, Jesus Christ, who serves as our high priest. We know also that the priest was continually standing. There was no place for him to sit in the tabernacle or in the temple, because when he was there, he was serving. He was ministering to the Lord the entire time. We know that Jesus Christ, our great high priest, is what? Sitting at the right hand of the Father. He is seated because his work is complete. They were continually offering repeated offerings to the Lord. Jesus is that once for all offer. And they had to offer those sins over and over because they were ineffective. They literally just covered our sins for another year until the next day of atonement. But we know Jesus Christ not only covers, he removes our sin when we come to him by grace through faith. We know the Levitical system could never make us perfect. In fact, it really brought to light our imperfection, did it not? Our inability to keep the law. But Jesus cleanses, as we said, not just the outward, but also the inward. He cleanses our conscience. The Levitical system was an outward picture of what Jesus Christ would accomplish for us in our inner man. It's a beautiful picture. And the Levitical system was created to point to the divine, who is Jesus Christ. So we see how the Levitical system points to Christ, was not sufficient to forgive us of our sins, but merely covered our sin. But in Jesus Christ, all that it pointed to is completely fulfilled. Let's look at verse 14. It says, "For by one offering, he has perfected for all time those who are sanctified," or are being sanctified, as some translations say. This tells us that we have a positional sanctification. We are perfect because we're in Christ for all time, but it also lets us know that we are being sanctified. Because can I get a witness? I'm not perfect yet. In and of myself, I'm not perfect. I still fail. I still have weaknesses. I still find myself sinning or having a wrong attitude or a wrong motive for desiring something. And I have to come to Christ and confess that so that I may walk blamelessly before him. But I know that positionally, because I am in Christ Jesus, seated in heavenly places, I am perfect in him. But I'm also taking part in a progressive sanctification. He is the one who will complete and perfect our sanctification until the day we see him face to face, when we realize it in actuality. Now let's jump down to verses 19 through 24. And these verses are literally one long sentence. It's one complete sentence. So we're going to read 19 through 24. "Therefore, brethren, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he inaugurated for us through the veil, that is his flesh. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a sincere heart, a pure heart, and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds." So that's all one sentence. As we process through that and we recognize that he is saying, these are the reasons you have confidence to enter into the Holy of Holies. Because of Christ, we can enter and not be destroyed by God's holiness. His holiness now has come to reside within us in our inner man. In fact, in Isaiah 57:15, it says, "The high and lofty one who lives in eternity, the Holy One, says this, 'I live in the high and holy place with those whose spirits are contrite and humble. I restore the crushed spirit of the humble and revive the courage of those with repentant hearts.'" He is high and holy, but who does he dwell with? Those who have a broken spirit, who are contrite in heart, who have dedicated their entire beings to him, the pure in heart. They're allowed to see him, to experience his manifest presence. And that is what he desires for us to experience on a daily basis as we spend time with him in our quiet place, in our place where we meet with him, where we meditate upon him, where we ask him to speak to us through his word, where we lift our requests back to him and we listen for him to impress and speak into our spirit man through his word and also through his spirit who lives within us. As we make him the preeminent relationship in our life, the one upon whom we set our affections as a choice, an act of the will. And when we do that, then the feelings of adoration follow that choosing to set our hearts and our minds on Christ Jesus. Father, we love you, we bless you, we praise you. Lord, we are in awe that the Holy One has made the way for us in Christ Jesus. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You know, there's not a lot of times in the New Testament when you really can read about what early worship was like, but today we have one of those few instances that we get to look inside and see a first century worship service. There's going to be a little bit of talking before we get there, but I just believe that we ought to try to emulate, we ought to try to imitate, we ought to try to be like the people in the book of Acts. I've thought that all of my life, ever since I've ever started living for the Lord back when I was 19 years old, 40 years ago. I just realized, you know, we need to be like them. We don't need to just look around and try to be the latest fad or whatever. But what did they do in the New Testament? What did they do in the book of Acts? What did they do as primitive Christians? Let's talk today about first century Christianity, primitive Christianity. Look there in Acts chapter 20. After the uproar had ceased, Paul sent for the disciples, and when he had exhorted them, that means he encouraged them, and taken his leave of them, he left to go to Macedonia. When he had gone through those districts and given them much exhortation, underline the word exhortation, he came to Greece, and there he spent 3 months. These were the winter months, and you couldn't sail on the sea at that time. It was too dangerous, and so he stayed there at Corinth, we believe. And when a plot was formed against him by the Jews as he was about to set sail for Syria, he was on his way to Jerusalem, he decided to return through Macedonia. And he was accompanied by, now look at all these people that he had led to the Lord in the different places, Sopater of Berea, the son of Pyrrhus, Aristarchus and Secundus of the Thessalonians, Gaius of Derbe, Timothy and Tychicus, and Trophimus of Asia. Wow. Seven people. But these had gone on ahead and were waiting for us at Troas. We sailed from Philippi after the days of unleavened bread, that's the Passover, and came to them at Troas within 5 days. Now, it must have been windy that time because when they had sailed the other way from Troas to Philippi, it had only taken 2 days. Now it takes 5 days to go back. And there we stayed 7 days. We're at Troas. Now here's the worship service. Look at verse 7. On the first day of the week, what day is that? Sunday. On the first day of the week, when we were gathered together to break bread, Paul began talking to them, intending to leave the next day, and he prolonged his message until midnight. You guys think I preach long. Have a Sunday night service, by the way. Sunday night church right there in the Bible. There it is. And he preached till midnight. Paul, I love you. There were many lamps in the upper room where we were gathered together, and there was a younger man named Eutychus sitting on the windowsill, sinking into a deep sleep. And as Paul kept talking, he was overcome by sleep and fell down from the third floor and was picked up dead. But Paul went down and fell upon him. After embracing him, he said, "Don't be troubled. His life is in him." He had died, and God raised him from the dead. Verse 11, when he had gone back up, that is Paul, had gone back up to the third floor, and broken the bread and eaten, he talked with them a long while until daybreak. That is all night long. The service went all night long. And then he left. They took away the boy alive and were greatly, one version says, not a little comforted. Now that just gives us a little insight. It doesn't tell us everything that took place. Surely they prayed. Surely they sang. Surely they did other things. They fellowshiped. But we see a little bit about what the early Christians were like. And I want to share that with you today. First of all, primitive worship, first century church emphasized biblical preaching. Biblical preaching. Look there in verses 1 and 2. After the uproar had ceased, Paul sent for the disciples. When he had exhorted them, underline that in your Bible. Very strong word for preaching. When he had exhorted them and taken leave of them, he left to go to Macedonia. It's repeated again in the next verse, verse 2. When he had gone through those districts and had given them much exhortation, he came to Greece. Paul was a soul winner. He led people to Jesus Christ, but he also helped disciple and ground new Christians in the ways of Jesus. It was not either or for Paul. It was both and. He loved to win people to Christ, but he also loved to help Christians grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And how did he do that? By exhorting them. The word exhort is parakaleo. Para means together. Kaleo means to call together, to come together. That's how you do it. You come over here, let's come together, and I want to encourage you. I want to exhort you. I want to build you up. Paul did that by preaching the word of God. By the way, parakaleo is the same word used to refer to what the Apostle Peter was doing when he was preaching on the day of Pentecost and 3,000 people got saved. We read back in Acts chapter 2, verse 40, with many other words, Peter solemnly testified and kept on exhorting, parakaleo. He kept on exhorting them, be saved from this perverse generation. Everywhere these Christian preachers would go, They would exhort. They would encourage. Why? Because the devil is the great discourager. How many of you know that the devil is all about discouraging Christians? Does anybody know that? So we need to put courage back in them. And by the way, I read this week several times in my New Testament, God says he wants us to take courage, Drew, to take courage. You can't just say, well, I hope courage comes to me. You need to reach out and take it. You take it when you read the Word of God. You take it when you pray. You take it when you talk about Jesus and when you think about Jesus and you focus on Jesus. Some of you are waiting for courage to come your way. God's saying, it's right here, but you've got to take it. That's the way salvation is right? You got to take it. You got to receive it by faith, by grace through faith in Christ. And so he was exhorting them, and they were taking courage. And the Bible says then, look down at verse 7, on the first day of the week when they were gathered together to break bread, Paul began talking, underline that, talking, dialoguing to them, intending to leave the next day. And he prolonged his message until midnight. And I'm telling you, every preacher in the world thanks God for that little phrase right there. He began to dialogue, dialegomai, to talk with them, to discuss, to not just a monologue. You know, they would preach, and then he'd stop and say, okay, any questions, any comments? And they'd have dialogue. And he taught them with questions. He taught them answering their questions, but he would answer their questions as well. And I think we're going to need to do more of that in our Sunday school classes, our life groups, and all the other classes we have. I really believe that we need more dialogue, not just monologue where you think you're teaching. We need dialegomai. We need where we're answering people's questions, because I want to say this to you. There's a lot of people that have a lot of questions that need to be answered. If we don't answer them, the devil will try to, all right? And then look at verse 11. When he had gone back up and had broken the bread and eaten, he talked. Underline that. There's a great word. He talked with them a long while. That's homileo. You ever heard the word homily? It's a sermon. He talked with them. He conversed with them. Homiletics is the discipline of preaching and writing a sermon. So you have all these words. Parakaleo, he exhorted them. Dialegomai, he discussed with them about the word, the message, logos. And then he, homileo, he talked, he conversed with them. That's what they did. They preached the word of God in primitive Christianity. Why is a pulpit in the middle of a Baptist platform? Why don't we have an open chancel like a lot of churches? And I'm not putting any church down. Why don't we have the Lord's Supper table here with no pulpit? I'll tell you why. Because the preaching of the Word of God is central in any worship service. Paul certainly believes so. We read in the Bible what Paul thought about preaching in 1 Corinthians 1:18, for the word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it's the power of God. And by the way, why did the Jews have such a, why did Paul, even before he got saved, why did they have such a hard time with Christianity? Why were they having a hard time with Jesus being the Messiah? Why do they have a hard time right now? I'll tell you why. Because in Deuteronomy it says that anybody that goes to a cross, anybody that dies by crucifixion, anybody that is nailed to a cross is accursed by God. And they could not believe that the Messiah would be cursed by God. That's why he just said there, to them, the cross is a stumbling block. It's foolishness to those who are perishing. But you know, really, that is what happened. Aren't you grateful today that Jesus took your curse while he was on the cross? Jesus took the curse of your sin. Jesus became sin for you. And so, really, the Jews are exactly right. He was accursed of God so that we could be blessed of God. Hallelujah belongs there. 1 Corinthians 1:21, Paul said this about preaching, for since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom didn't come to know God, God was well pleased through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. God says, the world thinks this is foolish. What I'm doing right now is foolish. Why would you waste your time? I'll tell you why. This is not the word of Bellevue. This is not the word of some Baptist church. This is not the word of some preacher. This is the word of Almighty God. Amen. And so we're hearing from God, not from Steve Gaines. Who cares about hearing from Steve Gaines? Steve Gaines doesn't even want to hear from Steve Gaines. I want to hear from God. Paul said this about preaching in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. He said in verses 4 and 5, my message and my preaching were not in persuasive words of wisdom. I wasn't trying to impress you with my intellect, although Paul could have. What a wise man. What a very studied man. But rather in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith would not rest on the wisdom of men, but on the power of God. And then the greatest statement Paul had to say about preaching was to his young preacher Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4. This is the last chapter Paul ever wrote. We see it in verse 1. I solemnly charge you, Timothy, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready. Timothy, be ready in season and out of season, when you feel like it and when you don't feel like it, when it's popular, when it's not popular. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with great patience and instruction, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but wanting to have their ears tickled. That's where we are today. They will accumulate for themselves teachers, hirelings, in accordance to their own desires, and will turn away their ears from the truth and will turn aside to myths. But you be sober in all things, Timothy. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. And whatever you do, you fulfill the ministry God has given you to preach the word of God. Oh, guys, we want to be like the early Christians. We got to have Bible preaching. Number two, the primitive church also emphasized diverse congregations. You say, where? Verse 3. And there he spent 3 months. And when a plot was formed against him by the Jews, as he was about to set sail for Syria, he decided to return through Macedonia. Here's how that came out. He was about to get on a ship, and apparently he heard about that there were some Jews on there that didn't like him very much. And he started thinking, okay, if they wanted to bump me off, it'd be real easy for them to kill me on the ship and just throw me overboard, and nobody'd ever know the difference. So I feel led of God not to go on this ship. I think I'll just go by way of land. Bible says he started out on land. He took his buddies with him. Look at verse 4. And this is what I want you to see. He was accompanied by Sopater of Berea, son of Pyrrhus, Aristarchus, Secundus of the Thessalonians, Gaius of Derbe, Timothy, Tychicus, Trophimus of Asia. These 7 men represented churches from all over. They were diverse, some from Asia, some from other parts of Macedonia, all over the place, different ages, different ethnicities, a diverse congregation. You know, I thank God that when I come to Bellevue Baptist Church, it seemed like every week it looks more and more like heaven and it looks more and more like Memphis. Amen? I thank God for, aren't you glad for every ethnic group in this room? Amen? Amen. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad for every age group in this room? Let's clap for that too, all right? Yeah. Yeah. Some have money, some don't. Some have education, some don't. Some are black, some are white. Some are other colors. And you know what? None of that matters. Everybody in here has a soul, and everybody in here is worth the blood of Jesus. Jesus thought so. He died for your sins. He rose from the dead to give you eternal life. And we have diversity. We have unity in our belief in Jesus. We have unity in our theology on all the major points. Now, we might differ a little bit on Calvinism or differ a little bit on some other things, but the main thing is this: we believe that Jesus is the Son of God, the Bible is the Word of God, salvation is only in Jesus Christ, it's by grace through faith in Christ, and we believe that we are called to make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that He's commanded us, and if we'll do that, lo, behold, He'll be with us always, even to the end of the age. We believe those things, and those are the things that hold us together. Plus, we believe so strongly that Jesus Christ is our Lord and our Savior. You know, we live in a land that is increasingly divided racially, increasingly divided in other ways, politically in other ways. I just want to say, as far as I'm concerned, let's park that at the doors, amen? What can the church do when it comes to diversity? First of all, if the doors are not open to anybody, we ought to shut the doors. Secondly, anybody that is sincere, I mean, they genuinely want to know about Jesus, they want to get saved, they want to get baptized, you know what? They can join our church. If they want to come and believe what we believe about the Bible, I'm not saying that, that we're going to be on every little thing together. Simply, we want you to come because you love the Lord. And then one more thing, we want you to know that in case you're wondering, you better get used to being around different kind of people, because heaven is integrated. Can I have an amen in the house of God on that? All right. Yeah, so, all right. Paul said, and by the way, we can have different spiritual gifts and all that. Paul said in Romans 12, just as we have many members in one body, all the members do not have the same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ and individually members one of another. Let's just remember that all of us are important, and we need everybody to be a catalyst for spiritual awakening in Memphis and beyond. Thank God that we want to be like the early church. We want to have a diverse congregation. Okay, let me get moving here. These last points, always I kind of go through them quicker than the first points, all right? Point three, the primitive church also emphasizes Sunday worship. Now, I'm not saying it's wrong to worship God on any other day, but there's something about the first day of the week that I believe is important to God. Listen to this in verse 7. On the first day of the week, when we were gathered together to break bread, underline that, break bread, highlight it, Paul began talking to them, intending to leave the next day, and he prolonged this message until midnight. After Pentecost, Acts chapter 2, many of the Jewish Christians continued to observe the Jewish practices. They would go to the temple to pray at certain hours. They would go and, you know, they would worship on the Sabbath, which was Saturday. But by Acts 20, you see a lot of that fading away. And now they have chosen to worship on the first day of the week because Jesus Christ rose from the dead, not on the Sabbath, but on Monday, on the Lord's Day is what they would call it. And that's why. Now, I've had some Christians take me to task on this. I've had people, I had a guy stop me in the grocery store. I was minding my own business, just buying some Gatorade, all right? I tell you, you know, when you're a preacher, man, you're on all the time, man, you know what I mean? And so I was sitting there just trying to buy my little Gatorade, and he, I want to show you something. He started reading it. It seemed so innocent at first, and then, boy, he lowered the boom. He said, why don't you worship on Saturday? He read this to me. Remember the Sabbath to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor, do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of the Lord, your God. In it you shall not do any work, you or your son, your daughter, male or female servant, cattle, sojourner who stays with you. For in the 6 days God, the Lord, made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. And therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. And all I could say to him is, well, you know, Jesus got in a lot of trouble for the way he believed about the Sabbath. He said, what do you mean? I read to him Mark chapter 2, verses 27 and 28. Then Jesus said to them, the Sabbath was made to meet the needs of people, and not people to meet the requirements of the Sabbath. The Son of Man is Lord even over the Sabbath. Jesus said, I didn't make the Sabbath to hurt you. I made the Sabbath to help you, not to hinder you, but to help you. Yes, we should take one day out of the week, but the early Christians chose the first day. I want to tell you why. There's just something about putting God first. Today is the first day of the week. I think it's wise for you to be. Now, look, I'm not putting people down that go on Sunday night. Don't go out here and say, Brother Steve said all those other people are sinning. I didn't say that. I'm just saying there's something about Sunday. There's something about Sunday where God says, this is the Lord's Day. You're celebrating the resurrection. You know, every Sunday is Easter in a church. We're celebrating the resurrection of Jesus. We're celebrating the fact that Jesus is alive. And so, first day of the week, there's just something about that. John, when he was on the Isle of Patmos, said in Revelation 1, verse 10, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. What is that? That's the first day of the week. And you can have multiple services, multiple venues for worship. I'm all for anybody worshiping God at any time, but I believe there's something about Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. I believe in the first fruits. I believe in giving. When I call me a legalist, I want to, nowadays, if you just obey the Lord, somebody calls you a legalist. If you just obey God, I just want to say this to you. I'm not a legalist, but I want to obey God. God blesses obedience. And God says, give God the first of your money. Proverbs chapter 3. Verses 9 and 10, honor the Lord from your wealth and from the first of all your produce. You don't pay all your bills and give God a little leftover. I want to say this to you. Great churches are not built with pocket change and spare time. Great churches are built when we put God first with our time. That's why the first thing I do when I woke up, I woke up early this morning. I went to bed early last night. I went to bed early. You know why? You need sleep. So I went to bed early so I could get up early. I got up early. I read my Bible. I pray. That's the first thing. I'm not trying to impress you. I'm just trying to tell you, I've got to have that. And you know what? It's just like anything else. The more you do it, the more you want to do it. I can't get enough. It's just like I got to meet with the Lord. And so I got to seek Him first. There's so many times I have not sought Him first, and I've paid for it. I'm 59 years old. I don't want to go out. I don't want to go out not really living for Christ. So I think there's something special that we're here together today, and we're saying, Lord, we love You so much. We put You first. We're here on the Lord's Day. We're here on the first day of the week. We're here on Sunday to dedicate the whole 168 hours to You so that You can just know that we're going to put You first. We're going to seek first the kingdom of God. That's part of what they did in the early church. Number four, the primitive church emphasized meaningful ordinances. Look at verse 7. On the first day of the week when we were gathered together to break bread, underline that, Paul began talking to them, intending to leave the next day, and he prolonged the message until midnight. The early church observed two ordinances, the baptism and the Lord's Supper, and both of these ordinances helped them share the gospel. They were pictures of the gospel. Baptism was a clear picture of the death, burial, and resurrection. Baptism was done by immersion. In the name of the triune God, sometimes they would baptize also in the name of Jesus. There's about four or five times in the book of Acts they did that. And then it was also a symbol of their salvation. It was not salvific. It was not something they did to be saved. It was something they did because they were saved. And then they had the Lord's Supper. It was a picture of the death, the vicarious, the atoning death of Jesus Christ. The Bible says down in verse 11 also, when he had gone back up, this is after the boy had been healed and raised from the dead, and broken the bread and eaten it, he talked with them a long while until daybreak, and then he left. Now, what's going on here? I'll tell you what they did. They had something they called the love feast. They had the agape feast. We do that here at Bellevue close to Thanksgiving. They did it on a regular basis. They had these meals. And you say, what is that? Don't tell me you don't know what it is. They went to the fellowship hall and they had a big meal. That's what they did. Why? Because there's a lot of poor people. A lot of people had lost their jobs because they were Jewish Christians or they were Gentiles and their families were turning them away and they'd lost their jobs and a lot of them were poor and they just needed some food, and so the people that had food would share their food, and they did that in these love feasts. And during that time, they would take the Lord's Supper. They usually did all this. They had their worship services in their homes, and so they would have these meals together, and then in the middle of it, one of the pastors would lead them and say, okay, let's take some bread here. Let's take the cup with the juice or wine. And they would take that and they would say, okay, the body of Jesus is represented in this bread. Break it like He was broken for us on the cross. Take it and do this in remembrance of Him. And then take that cup, and that wine or that juice is representing the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. You can't be saved by anything else but the blood of Jesus. Take it and drink. And they would sing hymns, the Bible says, and they would worship the Lord. That's what we are doing still to this day. Isn't that something? In fact, there's a verse that says we'll do that until the Lord comes. 1 Corinthians 11:26. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death, and look at this little phrase, until He comes. Number five, the primitive church emphasized encouraging unity. This is so important. You've got to guard the unity in the church. Look at verse 7. On the first day of the week when we were gathered together to break bread, Paul began talking to them, intending to leave the next day. He prolonged his message until midnight. There were many lamps in the upper room where we were gathered together. There it is, twice, gathered together. It's the word sunago. What does that sound like? Synagogue. A coming together of people. Gathering together, bringing together. Christians need to come together. Christianity is not something for people that want to be the Lone Ranger. God wants you to be around other Christians, fellowship. He wants you, iron sharpens iron, the Bible says in Proverbs. He wants there to be unity also in that body. A couple of three things I'd say here. As a believer in Christ, your best friends, I'm talking about your best friends, do not need to be lost people. They will drag you down more than you can pull them up. When I was a youth pastor, I would always talk to our kids about this. And I would say, okay, some of y'all come here, and I'd get two of them here, and I'd get this big, strong guy and stand him up in a chair. You know, these guys always think they're real big and tough and everything. And I'd get this little girl and put her down below. I said, now, you pull her up in that chair. And he'd pull and pull. He couldn't get her. I said, now, you just tug. And she just barely tugged, and she could get him off that. I said, it's easier to pull somebody down than it is to pull somebody up. And the devil wants to pull you down. Did you know that? Devil wants you to blow your testimony. The devil wants you not to live for Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15:33. Don't be deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals. Let's read that last part together. Bad company corrupts good morals. And then as a believer, saved godly people must be your closest friends. We read in Hebrews 10 why we should not miss fellowshipping and worshiping together corporately. Hebrews 10, 24 and following says, let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. Let us not neglect our meeting together. There it is. Don't neglect the meeting together. Say, oh, I can watch online. I thank God for online if you're sick or if you're debilitated. But I got news for you. It's not the same. It is not the same. And I know we got a lot of people watching us right now. And I know that a lot of them are debilitated. But I want to say this to you. It's important to get around other Christians. We encourage one another. Meeting together. Some people do encourage one another, especially now that the day of His return is drawing near. And once we get together, we need to be nice. We need to be in harmony with each other. 1 Corinthians 1:10 says it this way. Paul said, I appeal to you, dear brothers and sisters, by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ, to live in harmony with each other. Let there be no divisions in the church. Rather, be of one mind, united in thought and purpose. The early church, why were they so blessed of God? One reason is they were unified. They were fellowshipping. They were together on the Lord's day. The last thing is this. The primitive church emphasized supernatural manifestations. You don't get any more supernatural than this guy named Eutychus. Look at this in verse 7. He's a young boy, somewhere between 8 and 14, according to the word that they used for young man. On the first day of the week, when we were gathered together to break bread, Paul began talking to them, intending to leave the next day. He prolonged his message until midnight. There were many lamps in the upper room where we were gathered together, and there was a young man named Eutychus sitting on the windowsill. He was there where there was more air than any place, but it still didn't work. Sinking into a deep sleep. He probably worked all day. And the reason they had Sunday night church is because you got a lot of poor people here. Some of them might have been slaves. They didn't have the option of choosing their own hours. They had to worship at night. They worked all day long, like Paul did in the leather shop or in the tent making shop, whatever you want to call it. There was a young man named Eutychus sitting on the windowsill, sinking into a deep sleep. As Paul kept on talking, he was overcome by sleep. He fell down from the floor and was picked up dead. Now, you're talking about breaking up a sermon. That would do it, would it not? But Paul, I like that little phrase, a little conjunction there. But Paul went down, he fell upon them, upon him, and he embraced him. Where did he get that? He got that from Elijah. He got that from Elisha. He read his Bible. He knew. God, the Holy Spirit, just laid it on his heart to do it. He said, after embracing him, don't be troubled. His life is in him. Suddenly, life just came back into that boy. He died. That's what the text is talking about. He died. It's not that they thought he was dead. No. Like the English, the New English Bible says, he thought he was dead. No. He was dead. And he came alive. Don't be troubled. His life is in him. When he'd gone back up, he had broken the bread. He had eaten. He talked with them a long while until daybreak, and then he left. And they took away the boy alive. and they were greatly comforted. Now, why don't we see more miracles like that? You know what I have? I've got theologian friends that say, oh, that was for the day of the early Christians so that lost people could see the power of God and be saved. Oh, when the New Testament canon was complete. We don't have miracles like that today. Who says? Show me a verse. Give me a reference that says the miracles have stopped. Can I just make a statement? I think a lot of times we just kind of give in to something that somebody has said and we don't really study it. I want to say this to you. God is still God. God can save anybody. God can heal. God can deliver. God can set free. Whatever sin you're struggling with, Jesus Christ can set you free. If you're a drunkard, God can set you free from being a drunkard. If you're a dope addict, God can set you free from being an addict. If you are involved in some type of sexual immorality, I'm telling you, God can set you free from any kind of sexual immorality there is. God can bring your marriage back together. God can save your lost children. God can save your lost parents. God can still bring revival and awakening to the United States of America. God can fix anything that's broken because God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God can do that. The problem is not with God. It's with us. We're so materialistic. We're so wrapped up in this world, we don't pray like we should. We don't witness like we should. We don't live in the Word. We just kind of do a little along and say, a little dabble, do you? Well, it won't. When we get serious with God, God will get serious with us. And I'm praying, especially for some of you men out there, to rise up and be the man of God in your home, to start praying for your kids. Miraculous things can still happen. And the greatest miracle of all is when somebody gets saved.
Well, thank you for watching this broadcast from Bellevue Baptist Church. And I want to ask you a question. What is your relationship with Jesus Christ? We love to share Jesus here at Bellevue. And I'd like to take just a moment and share with you some very important things. First of all, I want you to know that God loves you. Some of you may think that God doesn't love you. Maybe you've had some things happen in your life and you say, well, Pastor, I've just been too bad for God to love me. I want you to know that is not the case. God loves you. He knows you. He created you. And He has a great plan for your life. And the Bible also says, though, that all of us do have a problem. It's called sin. The Bible says that all of us like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. That's what sin is. Doing what we want to do rather than doing what God wants us to do. All have sinned, the Bible says, and come short of the glory of God. And there is a punishment for sin. The wages of sin is death. And that means we're separated from holy God. He loves us, but we're sinners. And He wants to have fellowship with us. So He provided the way to have fellowship with God, and that is through His Son, Jesus Christ. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Who is that? Jesus. Jesus was born of a virgin. He was God, the Son, in eternity past, but He came to this earth through the womb of a virgin, and He was born that way because He was born without a sinful nature. Then He was tempted in all ways like we are, but He never yielded to sin. He never yielded to temptation, so He never sinned. And even though He was the sinless Son of God, the Bible says that He went to the cross and He died in our place as an atoning sacrifice. He paid our sin debt when He died on the cross. And then the Bible says that He was buried to prove that He was dead. But I want to give you some great news. Jesus rose from the dead and He is alive today. And He offers you eternal life. You might say, well, Pastor, how in the world can I receive forgiveness of sins and eternal life? Here's how. First of all, you repent of your sin. You ask the Lord to help you turn from your sin and to turn to Him. That doesn't mean that you'll never sin again, but it does mean that you're sorry for your sins and you ask God to forgive you. So you have to repent. You have to do a spiritual U-turn, if you will. And then you have to believe that Jesus didn't just die for everyone, but He died for you. And that He rose from the dead to give you eternal life. And then you have to receive Him and invite Him to come into your life. And the moment you call upon the name of the Lord and receive Jesus as Lord and Savior, that means He's in total control of your life, you become a Christian. I believe some of you would like to do that right now. So I would like to lead you in a time of prayer, just a very quick prayer, but a very sincere prayer, where you're not just mouthing words, but you're truly repenting of your sin, believing savingly in Jesus, and receiving Him as your Lord and Savior. If you'd like to do that with me, join me right now. Just pray something like this. Say, "Dear Lord Jesus, thank you that you love me. I am a sinner. I cannot save myself. Lord, I repent of my sin. I turn from my sin. And Lord, I pray that you'll forgive me for my sin. I believe that you died on the cross and you paid my sin debt. And then I believe you rose from the dead and you're alive right now. I call upon your name. I receive you. Save me right now, Lord Jesus. And by faith, I thank you that you've come into my life. And Lord, help me to walk for you and to live for you for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name, amen." Dear friend, if you prayed to receive Christ, you're a Christian right now. Old things have passed away, new things have come. And I want you to call that toll-free number on your screen. Someone is waiting here at Bellevue to pray with you and to thank God for what He's doing in your life. We want to send some materials to you as well. They'll be free. If you need a Bible, let us know. That will be free as well. And then we want you to come and worship with us at Bellevue Baptist Church. You'll see the times and the locations momentarily. Thank you for watching. God bless you. And again, if you receive Christ, call right now. Have a great day.
If you're in need of spiritual help, call us at 1-866-347-5431. There are caring people waiting right now to take your call. For more information about Bellevue, explore our website at bellevue.org, where you can catch up on recent messages from Pastor Steve and other great teachers through our audio and video on demand. And tune in to our live webcast every Sunday at 9:20 and 11 a.m. and Sunday evening at 6 p.m. Follow us on social media at Bellevue Memphis throughout the week for inspirational and encouraging stories. We'd also like to invite you to join us for worship at one of our four locations around Memphis. Our main campus is located at I-40 and Appling Road. You're always welcome, and there's a place for your family to worship and connect. Check out bellevue.org for a complete list of worship times. We look forward to seeing you soon.